Once again, the former president had a Republican entourage with him in court today, including more vice presidential hopefuls. And this time, Speaker of the House, second in line to the presidency, Speaker Johnson, used the opportunity to take shots at today's star witness, something the former president is barred from actually, of course, doing.
This is a man who is clearly on a mission for personal revenge and who is widely known as a witness who has trouble with the truth. He is someone who has a history of perjury and is well known for it. No one should believe a word he says today.
Speaker Johnson also professed the innocence of the former president and called the trial a sham. His appearance led former Congresswoman, January 6th Committee Vice Chair Liz Cheney, to write this on X. I'm surprised that Speaker Johnson wants to be in the I cheated on my wife with a porn star club. I guess he's not that concerned with teaching morality to our young people after all. And right here in New York, a big fundraiser headlined by the former president, co-hosted by the parents of Jared Kushner. Attendees include more contenders for Trump's VP pick, including Senators Marco Rubio and Tim Scott, and South Dakota Governor Kristi Noem. Joining us to discuss is CNN senior political commentator David Axelrod. She did not bring the dog.
Yes, lock up your dog. She's in town.
The dog is no longer with us.
Yeah, I know.
What a bizarro. I mean, this really reflects how strange this campaign is. I mean, it used to be that vice presidential candidates would go, you know, to party dinners and they do television interviews and so on to sort of audition for the vice presidency. Now they show up in court in support of their candidate who is on trial for what he's on trial for, and they're, you know, basically carrying his words out to the world. But I'm relieved that Speaker Johnson is offended by people who don't always tell the truth.
The Trump campaign released a fundraising video that, according to them, was shot inside the courthouse today. Lara Trump, Eric Trump appear in it with Vivek Ramaswamy. Donald Trump himself actually pops up at the end to give a thumbs up. Is that a first, a fundraising appeal from a courthouse?
I would think so, but I don't have anything to compare it to because we've never had a president who's been on trial in the middle of a campaign either. But listen, it does speak to the place that Donald Trump is in right now in terms of the Republican Party. He is a force. They think he is doing well in this campaign. These guys want to be vice president. That's why they're turning up. It's a command performance in some ways. And for Speaker Johnson, look, Donald Trump basically allowed him to survive. He went down to Mar-a-Lago, he made his peace with Trump, and Trump basically stood down. If he had put his shoulder to the wheel, he could have deposed Johnson when Marjorie Taylor Greene did what Marjorie Taylor Greene did. Or certainly made it harder for him. So he is paying back a debt and buying an insurance policy on his future tenure as Speaker of the House.
Jeff, I mean, do you think people, like jurors, notice who's in the courtroom behind?
I'm going to speak as a Manhattan resident. I don't think a lot of Manhattan residents know who Mike Johnson is or what he looks like. So I don't think that is...
Well, also, he wasn't actually in the courthouse today.
He wasn't in the courthouse.
He just made it sound like he was coming in.
You know, to be honest, no. I don't think they notice. Now, you know, this all made me think of, you know, the way the Kardashian name became famous was because Robert Kardashian... who was technically a lawyer, but not really a lawyer, was part of O.J. Simpson's entourage during his trial. And that's how, you know, that name became famous. But here, I think this is much more of an inside political game to gain favor with Donald Trump than it is to affect either the jury or even people in Manhattan.
It's also, Trump is doing what Trump did before the 2020 election. He is pre-spinning a result. And they are abetting that effort in delivering a message that this is a political trial, that there's no foundation for it, that Michael Cohen is a lying reprobate who's bent on revenge. This is all part of what Trump does so well, which is to kind of set the terms of the debate. So if things go badly, he can say, well, we all know what this is about. Yeah, Caitlin, and they're now a party to it.
Caitlin, you spoke to Doug Burgum about the trial. He was there. Let's just spoil that.
When you've got a judge that donated to Joe Biden, when you've got prosecutors that supported Joe Biden, when you've got the judge's family members that are benefiting financially as Democrat operatives, and then when you've got, as you just said on the lead-in, this whole trial, you know, rests on the credibility of someone who spent 3 hours this morning describing in great detail how he lied to a grand jury, how he lied to a Congress, and how he lied in court cases. And so this is it's just a tough thing. I mean, I prosecution's got a tough job to try to build their case on someone who's a serial perjurer.
You know, the one thing that sitting there listening to Michael Cohen testify, which is, of course, who you're referring to, I mean, Donald Trump hired Michael Cohen. So for everything that you just said, I mean, that is the person that Donald Trump chose to be his personal attorney.
Well, I think, that's true that he did hire him, but I think that when the cross-examination, you're going to come out, you heard a glimpse of it this morning, that Michael Cohen leveraged a title that he had. He wasn't even doing work for President Trump, and he was signing up clients left and right at $4 million in revenue, leveraged that.
It's actually interesting saying he wasn't even working for Donald Trump. That's part of the prosecution's evidence in the case. I don't think they're going to be calling him Doug Burgum as a witness. But, I mean, it just shows that, you know, if you don't know the facts of the case, maybe you shouldn't talk so much.
You better
about
be careful. They're going to take that red tie back.
But also, what's so interesting about this, I mean, is this is also clearly a tryout for people who either want to be vice president, people like Doug Burgum, or want to be in the cabinet or are hoping Donald Trump will help them with their political fortunes. It wasn't that long ago when Doug Burgum was challenging Donald Trump for the Republican nomination. He was asked if he'd ever do business with Donald Trump, and he said no, and he said that the reason that was is because he just believes it's important that you're judged by the company you keep. Now that he is seeking to be Donald Trump's vice president, he is obviously out there arguing on his behalf. The other thing that I've also found interesting that we've heard from Doug Burgum and J.D. Vance, who seem to be out VPing each other here, is they both criticized the judge's daughter. That is exactly what Donald Trump was doing when they expanded the gag order to prevent him from doing it. I asked Doug Burgum if Donald Trump instructed him to do so, which would violate the gag order. He said no, that he was just here as a volunteer.
By the way, I'm sorry to keep harping on this, but we just showed another photo, a little wider shot of the one we just showed before.
They're
a fourth guy popped up in a red tie.
I mean, that's like, Corey Mills of Florida, Byron Donalds, Vivek Ramaswamy, obviously, and Doug Burgum.
They're spreading.
There are notes written on the back of those ties.
Can I ask Dan a quick question? You've obviously had a lot of experience advising Democratic candidates for president. If you were advising the Democratic nominee right now, would you tell him to go harder on Donald Trump's pending legal troubles? Put aside this hush money case. I know it has limited appeal. But how about the January 6th indictment, the classified documents? Do you think Joe Biden should be doing more and more aggressively on that?
Look, I think that when you look at the people that he needs to get, I think the people who feel strongly about that issue, at least at this juncture, he's getting those people. He may be able to persuade some at the end on this. The people he really needs to get and the people who are hanging back and aren't as engaged, they're very much motivated by things like economic issues. And I think he has to draw a sharp contrast on some of those issues. Now, in some ways, there's a lot of knowledge about this.
Well, on that point, the other thing that Doug Burgum did say that I think does resonate with voters when we look at the latest polls from the New York Times and Siena is he said Americans care more about their grocery bills than what's happening in that courtroom behind us. And I mean, that is a point that you don't hear from Donald Trump often when he comes and speaks to the cameras, but it is something that you have heard from a lot of these Republicans.
Oh, yeah. Listen, I've said from the beginning, if you're sitting around the kitchen table, and I feel strongly about these democracy issues, I think they're very, very important. But if you're sitting around the kitchen table talking about democracy and the future of democracy, probably because you don't have to worry about the cost of the food on your table. If you have to worry about that, it's more likely the thing on your mind. And I think there I've said before, I think the president needs to lean into those issues a lot more. He seems more intent on defending his economic performance and getting credit for the good work that he has done in many ways and not really advocating for people in a tough economy because of the inflation. Yeah.